So welcome to the 19th lecture. In the previous lecture, we saw two-dimensional FEM procedure. Now we'll quickly see the coding aspects.
Manual meshing.
We already seen 1D code. So this code we are not going into line by line, and only part of code is will be explained in detail, right? So now here the same, the geometry is rectangular conductor in that boundary, right? Now what we are doing is we are taking 51 by 51 grid effectively. So number of nodes along x and y axis are 51 and 51, and then the total number of nodes that will be 51 into 51, right? Then we are actually initializing global coefficient matrix. All the elements of C are made equal to 0. Similarly, B, the source matrix, is the entries are made equal to 0. Then we are actually, this grid that we will eventually get because of this, that actually we are getting the coordinates, x and y coordinates of those, all those grid points, which is simply, you know, now I am not going into the line by line, it is obvious, and students are generally good in coding. So some simple things like this I will not explain. So basically, by using this command, our geometry is 0 to 0.1 and 0 to 0.1 in both x and y direction, that is why 0.1, it is 100 mm on both x and y directions. So we are getting x and y coordinates of all the grid points by this command. Then you have this, after you have formed the grid on x axis, you will have, these are the nodes that you will get: 1 to 51, 52 to 102, and so on and so forth, 2551 to 2601. These will be the node numbers. So we are basically forming the P matrix. Now we have seen earlier there are three matrices, P, E, and T. P matrix has information of coordinates, right? So x and y coordinates here. So now here given domain is discretized into squares, and E square is divided into two triangular elements as shown here, one lower triangular element and one upper triangular element, right? And then we are actually filling the P matrix. Now we have already got the coordinates x and y, all these coordinates we have got. So we are basically populating the P matrix, right? So P matrix you will get like this. So there are total number of nodes will be 2601, that is 51 into 51. Remember, 51 nodes, so 50 segments, right? And then you will get P matrix as 2 by 2601, because there are 2601 nodes. So x and y coordinates of each of those nodes. So for example, node number 1, it is 00. Node number 2, it is 0.002 and 0 and so on. So first you go like this, then like this. So remember, we are doing
manual meshing.
In the next lecture, we will use Gmesh, which is a freeware meshing software, and this, work of bookkeeping of element numbers and node numbers can get avoided by using that Gmesh freeware software. Right. So here again, why we are going into this
manual meshing?
Because then this, your coding fundamentals will get consolidated in this. Then we can go to Gmesh, and then later on when we start looking at complex problems, we are not going to get into coding for each of those problems. We would have by then explained you at least two or three codes. Then you can develop codes for any other problem also using such logic. Then next is the T matrix. Now T matrix has information of where that what is the subdomain number and subdomain number of each element and the global node numbers of each element. So for example, this T matrix will be 4 by number of elements, is it not? 4 will be rows, in which first row, first entry will be, now this column, each column represents one element, and the first entry of that, of any column, is the subdomain number, and then these are the three global node numbers of that element, right? So here, then we will form the T matrix. Now what we will do is, we will take the lower triangular elements first. That means we will first take all the lower triangular elements, go to the second row, again lower triangular elements, finish all lower triangular elements, and then go to the upper triangular elements while forming the T matrix, right? So this you know again is you are running this you know index from i1 to m minus 1 and i1 to n minus 1. So you know you get the total, you span the whole geometry, and here we are taking same material everywhere, right? Actually speaking, you have two materials here, is it not? One is the copper conductor, surrounding the copper conductor you have air, but copper and air both are non-magnetic with mu r equal to 1, is it not? That's why we are talking of same, we'll give define them as same subdomain number, but actually speaking you could have named conductor as said subdomain number 1 and air as subdomain number 2, so that if you wanted to derive something exclusively for the conductor through the core, then you know you can for example calculate the energy associated with only material number 1 or material number 2, then in that case you have to define the two regions with different subdomain numbers. Is it clear? But here, since we are doing
manual machine,
we already know what are the coordinates of that central conductor and where it is lying. So we don't have to define them separately by two numbers. But you will find in commercial softwares, you will always have different materials, although their properties may be same, they are always numbered by different separate numbers. That we could have done here also, but just to reduce the coding effort, we have named it 1 by 1 only, because the material property is same. Mu r is 1 for both air as well as copper. Practically, because we have seen copper is diamagnetic, mu r is slightly less than 1, but for engineering purposes, mu r is 1 for copper, right? So now when you execute this code, so this subroutine is explained here that when for the first one, when h is equal to 1, index is 1, these three commands will result into 1, 2 and 53, 1, 2, 53. So these are the global node numbers for first element. Next time when you again go into this loop with h is equal to 2, you will get 2, 3, 53 as these three numbers, right? So by this way, you would have formed T matrix entries, or you would have got T matrix entries corresponding to all the lower triangular elements in the whole domain. Similarly, we can do it for upper triangular elements, right? So these T matrix entries, we already got it. So 1, 2, 5, 53, so that is why 1, 2, 53. So and this set of entries are for the lower triangular
elements.
And now when you execute again the similar code with these commands little bit different than the earlier one, you will now get, when h is equal to 1, you will get 1, 53 and 52 as the output of this subroutine. So 1, 53, 52, and similarly then when next time when you execute, it will be 1, 2, 54, 53 and likewise, right? So then at the end of this two subroutines being executed, then you would have got all the T matrix, okay. Now we will go to go further. Now this command a3n underscore elements is equal to size of T, what will happen? Now T matrix is 4 into number of, I explained you, it is 4 into 4 by number of elements, is it not? So that is why it is 4 into number of elements. So 4 will get assigned to A3, and number of elements which are there, that is number of columns, will get assigned to this variable n underscore elements by this command, right? Similarly, for the P matrix, A1 n nodes, n underscore nodes is size of size p, that will assign A1 as 2 because p matrix is 2 by number of nodes, is it not? And number of nodes will get assigned to n underscore nodes, right? And that is what, and then when you display those, number of elements will be displayed as 5000 and number of nodes as 2601. So now we will go further and see how we can form element coefficient matrices. So here we run a for loop from 1 to number of elements, and then we take in nodes, where in nodes will be now a matrix containing 3 entries corresponding to the global node numbers of that element. So for each element, then we will get in nodes those 3 corresponding global node numbers when we execute this statement, because the T matrix 2, 3, 4 entries are the global node numbers and the first entry is the subdomain number, is it not? So by this command we would get global node numbers of each element like this. For element number 1, it will be 1, 2 and 53 are the global node numbers. Having got those nodes, we need to get x and y coordinates of those node numbers. That now x and y coordinates are in P matrix, because P matrix has information about the coordinates. So by executing these two
commands,
x is equal to P1 comma nodes and similarly y, we will get in xc and yc the corresponding node, the x and y coordinates of these 3 nodes, right. So again xc and yc will be 3 by 1 matrix corresponding to x and y coordinates of these 3 global node numbers are corresponding to that element number under consideration, right. So for each element number we will get this information, which will be helpful to form element coefficient matrices, as we will see later. Now these equations we have seen earlier number of times now, and shape functions n1, n2 and n3 are given by this, is it not, these 3 expressions. So now we will call this y2 minus y3 as p1, x3 minus x2 as q1 and similarly the other, you know, 2 sets of, you know, expressions. Then we will call this p1 to q3 as, you know, given here to simplify our, you know, equations, and we will just in place of this we will just replace them by pi's and qi's, right. So these, as I said earlier also, these expressions would be required quite often when we do coding. Now we want to find, because see, in our geometry we have this rectangular conductor and then this is a air box. So as far as the material properties are concerned, both air and copper, they are non-magnetic, so mu r is 1. But what is the difference between the two? There is a current in this conductor, so that current we have to impose, right. So we have to find out all those elements which lie within this conductor so that we can assign current density, and correspondingly we find the B matrix for those elements, is it not?
The x coordinate and the y coordinate of the centroid of an element is the average of the x and y coordinates of the 3 vertices respectively.
And then we know this conductor, the coordinate, the leftmost point and the rightmost point here, topmost point, top and right and bottom and leftmost point, they are 0.03, 0.03 and 0.07, 0.07. Remember, we had this whole geometry from 0 to 100 mm, whereas this was from 30 to 70 mm, is it not? This conductor was from 30 to 70 mm in x direction. So we are, what we are checking? We are checking whether the x coordinate lies between 0.03 and 0.07. Similarly, if y coordinate lies between 0.03 and 0.07 of that centroid, then that element is within this, you know, rectangular area, is it not? For example, let us say we have one element like this, triangular element like this. Now we are calculating the centroid of that triangle which is at the center of that triangle. So that triangular that centroid, if it lies within this, then that triangle is lying within the conductor, is it not? And that's how, if that being the case, then we assign mu r mu as 4 pi into 10^7, because mu r is 1, mu 0 into mu r, is it not? Mu 0 into mu r, and then mu r is 1, and bj is 10^3. This is just we are taking an as an example. We are considering current density in this conductor as 10^3 ampere per meter square. So here just note what I have written, current density, or it can be ampere turn density. Because in a winding, now this is like a, this conductor is like a one turn winding, you can say, is it not? So what actually you have to feed in is ampere turn density. So when we will actually see transformer or rotating machines example, so there we will be defining the current carrying areas. So there we have to define ampere turn density. So ampere turns divided by the corresponding area, right? So that's what is fed there. And else means that element is outside this conductor area. Then again mu r is 1, but bj is equal to 0, because there is no current carrying part in this region, right? So bj is 0. This we have already seen, I think last time, area of the triangle is given by this, right? You can verify this by using the expression that we have got now for pi's and qi's. And then also absolute value of is taken, since in case the node numbers are not numbered in anticlockwise direction, in case, right? This also I have explained earlier. And then I have also probably in one of the previous slides, we in fact verified this by this expression, which is this, and the formula for area of triangle in terms of determinant, both come same. This we have seen earlier. Now we form element coefficient matrix. Now see, the element coefficient matrix is just formed by this one statement. It's so simple. In terms of coding effort, it's very, very straightforward. In just one statement, you are forming element coefficient matrix. How? Now this expression we have seen earlier. Cij is this. This we have seen. Now same thing we are putting it here, right? So C element ij. See, remember this is being run in the for loop for each element. So suppose element number 1, corresponding to that you will have now 3 by 3 matrix, is it not? So Mr. Sairam explained to you about this thing earlier. So this is like, various stacks, element 1, 3 by 3 matrix, element 2, 3 by 3 matrix, element 3, 3 by 3 matrix, right? So these are all those, stacks of 3 by 3 matrices that would get formed when you run the for loop for each element, right? So C, say for example first element, I goes from 1 to 2, 3, J goes from 1 to 3. So it will be 3 by 3 matrix for element 1, and then the expression is this, Cij is this, as simple as that, right? So then BE, the corresponding source contribution to that element will be BJ, J delta by 3. This also we have seen last time. The current density, if it exists in that element, it basically gets into each of those nodes. It gets apportioned to each of the nodes of three vertices of that element, triangular element, equally as J delta by 3. Right, so that is what is being done here. So this is what that J delta by 3, 1, 1, 1. Going further, now like we saw in case of 1D, now we will see how we form global coefficient matrix by combining all element coefficient matrices, right? So again we run a for loop starting with 1 to number of elements. For each element, we take element by element and go on appending the global coefficient matrix, right? Because why we have to do that? Each element will have 3 nodes. Some of the elements, some of the nodes of each element may be common to different elements, is it not?
Also, some edges can be common to two elements.
Each element we get
in this 3x1 column matrix named as nodes.
The corresponding global node numbers using the T matrix, right? Then we run this for I goes from 1 to 3, J goes from 1 to 3. So those 9 entries will be here when I and J run from 1 to 3. Now depending upon the corresponding global node number, that each entry, each of those 9 entries will get appended to
corresponding entries of the global coefficient matrix.
Is it not? Because here nodes I and nodes J, this will return the global node number, because nodes is a 3x1 matrix. So nodes I and nodes J will return global node number. So for example, here element 1 and 1 1 of element 1. In this case, for example, element 1, if you see our, bring this in front of you. So your first element is lower triangular 1 2 53, second is 2 3 54, then all 2500 elements, all lower triangular elements will get completed. Then the next one, 2501 element, will be 1 53 52,
and all such upper triangular elements,
right? So the first element has global node numbers of 1 2 and 53, right? And the nodes, that's why it is 1 2 and 53. Now when we run that, these two for loops, what we are going to get? Because this one is the global and that one is also the local node number of element 1, is it not? So that's why small c 1 1, that means 1 is element, its local node numbers 1 1. So effectively it is c small c 1 1, right? That basically gets appended to capital C 1 1, because this local node number 1 of element 1 is in fact global node number 1, is it not? So that is how you get, and here initial value is 0 for this capital C 1 1, because first time we are putting something there, right? Okay, so then capital C 1 1 will get filled with small c 1 1 of element 1.
Similarly, when I is equal to 1 and J is equal to 2,
1 2 of element 1 will get appended to capital C 1 2, because again the global node number of this local number 2 is again 2 only, right? So it is C 1, so C 1 2 will get appended. When I is equal to 1 and J equal to 3, so the local node number of first element, this is 3, but the global node number is 53, is it not? So C small c 1 3 of element number 1,
1 2 and 3 are local node numbers.
So 1 3 will correspond to 1 and 53 globally, is it not? So capital C 153 will get the value of small c 13 of element 1. Now you go to element number 2501, that means all, after having gone through all the lower triangular elements, we come to the first upper triangular element, which is 15352. Now here when we run this for that element, now C 11 is not 0, because this node number was already encountered when we got this element 1, and already you have in capital C 11 this value, small C 11 of element 1. To that now what will get appended, added small C 11 of element 2501. Effectively we have seen earlier, now this global node number 1 is common to this lower triangular element and this upper triangular element. So that is why small c 11 will be added twice in formation of global coefficient matrix, that is capital C 11 here for element number 1, and again capital when we again here it will get added to capital C11 when we consider 2501, is it not? So now, for example, this 53 element, 53 global node number will be common to how many elements? It will be common to 6 elements, is it not? Because there is one element like this, this second, then third, then this fourth, fifth, sixth. You can see that diagram and you will find this 53 will be common to 6 triangular elements.
Since the global node number 53 is common to 6 elements, the diagonal entry C5353 will get appended 6 times.
So, but this whole thing gets done in just one this statement. You may feel that it is so complicated, but it is just happening due to one this execution of this statement, is it not? Similarly for B matrix, the source matrix, here it is, you know, it is like one dimensional, that is element number 1 and its corresponding local node number, right? So BE of 1, local node number 1 of element 1 will get appended to the global B 1, right? And initially it is 0, first time it will get added. Second time when it is encountered again for this element 2501, again that node, global node number 1 will be encountered, right? So again, you know, here the corresponding contribution will of that element will get appended to capital B 1, is it not? And this goes on, and this is by the end of this we would have got then both global matrices capital C and capital BJ. And why we are calling this as BJ and not B? Because this has contribution of only source, current source, right? There will be another contribution and the corresponding modification when we impose boundary conditions, is it not? That is why we are calling this as only BJ. Now, you know, we apply the boundary conditions. So, what we are doing? So, the outermost boundary, we are specifying A equal to 0. So, all these global node numbers which are on the boundary, we have to specify their A equal to 0, right? Magnetic vector potential. And although it is magnetic vector, here of course it is a scalar potential, because I already mentioned the direction is already fixed, it is two dimensional problem. So, A is in only z direction. So, direction is already known. What needs to be determined is only the magnitude of A at every point, and every point means at each of these all nodes, right? Because we have converted this problem into, you know, a problem wherein we needed to calculate potential at every point in the domain, to a problem wherein we need to initially calculate potentials at only these grid points. Once you calculate grid point potential, then potential at any point within the in any element can be found out by using that formula A plus Bx plus Cy, that original our approximation, is it not? Okay, so now we want to make the diagonal, this also was explained to you when we saw the 1D code. We have to impose the conditions, for example, this A1 equal to 0. So, what you do is you make the corresponding diagonal entry 1 of diagonal element entry as 0, right? Easiest way to do is first you make all the entries as 0 and then make the diagonal entry 1, rather than, you know, searching which is the diagonal entry and, you know, so this makes it simple. So, this is straightforward, is it not? So, C of II means the diagonal entry is made 1, and all the orthogonal entries then already are becoming 0 by this command. And then right hand side you have to make it 0. So, for last time we I think saw one example A5 equal to 0 in 1D code, is it not? Do you remember that? So, the diagonal entry 5 we made it 1, and on the right hand side we made it 0, all off diagonal entries also are already 0 there. So, same thing we repeat for, so this was bottom edge, right? So, it was, you know, we are running from 1 to 51, because n and m are 51. So, 1 to 51 we are running. Then the second edge, vertical edge, we are taking from only 52 to 2500 because one is already assigned, and then we are adjusting this index so that we get this thing run from only 52 to 2500. Since this is a
manual machine,
that's why you know you have to little bit keep this bookkeeping. Then we need to remember that. But when we use you know, next lecture we will see use of freeware called as Gmesh, then it becomes, all these things become very easy, right? We don't have to worry about this keeping track of what is the, you know, node number, global node number, and where we want to impose what. And okay, so then same thing procedure that we use for this bottom edge is followed for vertical edge, then vertical edge, second vertical edge, and finally the top edge. So same procedure is followed, only here index for this I is adjusted so that we get proper this numbers of nodes when we execute this for loop. Okay, so now we are nearing the, you know, end of this code. So now this bj, although we are calling this bj, now this bj got modified with the boundary conditions, is it not? Bj got modified using boundary condition. Now it has got contributions from both J source and boundary condition. Now we know we have this matrix of the form CA is equal to B, is it not? We have seen this earlier. And then what we have to do is we have to invert now C. So A is C inverse B. Now in MATLAB and Scilab, both C inverse is given by this backslash. So C inverse is basically backslash. Now we have got solution in A. By doing this, by executing this command, we have got magnetic vector potential at all the unknown, all those points within the geometry except boundary point, because there we had already imposed the condition. Now in order to plot, we have to convert this A, which is a column vector, into a two dimensional vector, because our geometry is two dimensional, is it not? We don't, that it is of no use for us to have a column vector for the plotting purpose, because we need to plot it now as a two dimensional in the two dimensional space. So that is what we are doing now. We are converting this column vector into n by m matrix, right? And similarly two rows of p matrix, which are basically coordinates. That means what we have to do at each of the coordinates, now again p is a matrix of x and y coordinates. So that we have to convert it as a two dimensional matrix. So for each of those x and y coordinates in two dimensional plane, now we have to plot the corresponding A value, which is also now obtained, those that two dimensional values are obtained by converting the corresponding column vectors into
n by m matrix.
For example, here by this command vn matrix and this command here, so we are converting this column vector into n by n grid. Similarly, you know, this xx and yy, by executing this command, we get x and y coordinates in that n into m grid. So similar command in MATLAB, for example, is reshape, right? So those who are having MATLAB commercial software, they can use the same code with, you know, changing this to reshape. So having done that, now it is a, we need to plot. So if you want to have a surface plot, then you get, remember A is equal to 0 at the boundaries and A will be higher at the center. So by using this surf command, xx, yy, that is the now two dimensional grid, and vn potential. If you want to get a contour plot, then contour xy vn, and 25 means 25 number of contours. So this is how you get it. Thank you. So we will end this 19th lecture here, and then we'll see how the same coding can be done using Gmesh meshing software, which is a freeware. Thank you.